guys. Eric with Torq-Masters Industries. We're excited to talk more about the Torq Locker for the Toyota 8-inch clamshell front differentials. Our Torq Locker is a mechanical locking differential. It works fully automatically, so there's no added input from you, the driver, other than shifting into four-wheel drive in a front differential application. The beauty of that is there's nothing else to think about. There are no things to go wrong, like airlines or compressors that are failing or electrical components. It is fully mechanical and completely automatic. So the next question is, how does the Torq Locker work? And with this great little display we have going, we can show you how it works inside the open differential. When you shift into four-wheel drive in a front differential situation, you're going to receive equal torque left and right. The axle's locked. But when necessary, the one axle, or the one wheel, can overrun the other automatically. The locker does this without any input from the driver. The more resistance or the more traction it receives, the easier it's going to ratchet. But when you're in a slippery situation like off-road, gravel, mud, snow, sand, you're never going to slip a wheel. You're going to get equal traction left and right, and that's going to take you much, much further down the trail than, say, your open differential would. If you've ever been out in an off-road situation and you've been stuck with an open differential, you know the wheel with the least resistance, say the wheel in the sand or the snow or the mud, that gets all the traction, and one wheel is just sitting there doing nothing. In this case, when you're in four-wheel drive with a front locker, you're going to get equal traction to both tires at all times. This display that we're using is going to be the loudest the locker could ever be, because there's no oil involved, there's no differential housing, and there's no diff cover. So your differential, your locker, will be much quieter than this. So we highly suggest you get yourself a manual for your vehicle. It's going to give you a lot of important information before you get started. Torque specs, fluid capacities, and different procedures on how to remove your CVs, drive shafts, etc. So the installation process for the Torq Locker and the 8-inch clamshell front differential is really simple. Essentially, you're going to need to just remove the wheels and tires, the CV axles. You're going to need to get to that center section and remove that from the vehicle. The bulk of the installation process happens here on the bench. So it's easy, it's clean, and you're not working over your head or underneath the vehicle. And most of our customers can do the installation themselves with no specialty tools needed. We're going to show you some more detail right now in the installation video. Don't need to pull the solenoid off. You can leave that attached. Pull the four bolts and the whole unit comes out. So you don't want to pry too hard because you don't want to deform it. But it comes out real easy. Now we've got to get this intermediate shaft out. We can pry on that from the sides with two pry bars, and it should pop out because there's a circlip that engages the spider gears. That's it. So it's just getting that circlip out of the axle gear. Now we're ready to pull the cover off, now that the intermediate shaft is out. This diff actually does have spots to hammer on. And this cover has two alignment dowels too, which make it more difficult to get off if you're not trying to get it in a straight line. It does not want to go if it's not straight. And then, obviously, during reassembly, your vent's going to go to the top. And it should not go back any other way. The dowels should not line up. When you're taking out the crosspin, pay attention to the hole in the carrier and make sure it's not, there's no wiggle, there's no wobble. It should be a smooth yet stiff fit. Inspect the crosspin. Look for excessive wear. Any ridges or anything like that. So we're taking the spider gears out of the carrier, the open carrier here, and you essentially just reach in and rotate them up out of the way. And then the rest of them will fall out. And pay attention to all the washers, make sure they all come out with them. And your two axle gears will have washers on them as well. Yeah, your two cone washers are going to stay with these and you're not going to reuse them. The two thrust washers on the axle gears are going to get reused. And now, while you've got it all apart, and before you clean it, we can get this needle bearing out of the way. The ring gear was on this upper side. The other side is what comes out, this needle bearing on the driver's side. The easiest way is, this is an 1 3/16 socket. Looks like a 30 mil is pretty close as well, with an extension, and then pull it 6x6s and we can tap it out. You might need to, with a 6x6, you just need a little, oh, there it is. Bushing is inserted into the outer sleeve from this direction. This outer sleeve has a solid surface here. And if you look on this side, you can see the inner bushing that the outer sleeve has a full lip. You can drive down on that nice and easy. You can either use the same socket, a little block of wood, or a driver kit if you have one. It's a little softer than the socket. So make sure that, make sure your bushing's in the right direction, and you can tap it nice and gently to get it started. Make sure it's going in straight. You gotta give it a good shot to get it started, and once you do, it'll find its happy spot. Flush the outside of the carrier there. So don't over smash it, but just drive it till you feel it bottom out. During reassembly, don't forget to put your thrust washers on, your stock thrust washers that you removed during disassembly, and make sure each axle gear gets a thrust washer. And then those will be inserted first on either side. And then you will align the cam gears left and right. They will key, they will only go in one way. Make sure you align the cross pin with the dowel pin that you're going to insert, and it just makes the installation easier. You don't have to try to turn it in place. You can make micro adjustments if you need to with a small pick or a screwdriver. Take your time putting your springs in. Doesn't hurt to have a thumb over your spring. Make sure they're fully seated down in the recess for the spring, and just make sure they're both in. Make sure you get that dowel pin fully seated into the cross pin. You're measuring your center gap. Just make sure you're within our tolerances, which are 145 thousandths to 170 thousandths. Make sure you clean the ring gear bolts. Get some brake cleaner on there, maybe even a little wire brush, get all the residue off so that way the new Loctite can really grab and do its job. So when you're reinstalling the intermediate axle shaft, just make sure, give it a twist, give it a turn, make sure you feel the teeth mesh and it's lined before you tap it into place. You're going to have to hammer it just a little bit with either a block of wood or like a brass hammer, but you need to get that circlip to engage the axle gear. And if you make sure that it's all lined up, everything will go in nice and smooth. If you don't get it in, this won't seat. Yeah, it just needs to, you're trying to align like three things at once. So they need to drive that axle gear in, that inner mid shaft, line it up, drive it in until you feel it touch the cross pin. Once you get the locker installed and you start to button up the differential, what you need to do is have the wheels and tires reinstalled for this next process. It is important, whether it's in the front or the rear, that the pinion is engaged. So in a rear differential, that means that the vehicle needs to be in park or in gear, or in the front differential, it needs to be in four-wheel drive and in park or, and in, or in gear. What that does is that sends resistance to the pinion so that you can perform the wheel spin test. And it's as follows. This is how you perform the wheel spin test. Take one wheel, let's say it's on the driver's side, rotate it backwards. Go to the passenger side, you're going to rotate it in the opposite direction. It should ratchet freely with no binding. The key to this is holding that initial wheel in the direction you started. If you don't, you can get varying results that are not accurate and will not prove that you're passing or failing the wheel spin test. So repeat it in the opposite direction. Take the driver's wheel and push it forward, and rotate the passenger wheel in the reverse direction. Again, no binding, free ratcheting. You're gonna then go to the opposite side. Roll that forward, rotate the driver's side in the opposite direction, and repeat in the other direction. That's all four directions. This vehicle, this differential, passes the wheel spin test.